President sir, will you please give a welcome address first? Then I will introduce the chairperson, and then the chairperson, Dr. Gyanraj and Dr. Amit Rai, will conduct the whole procedure. And at the end, I will request Dr. Rajesh Tongolkar to give the vote of address, vote of thanks.
Okay. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We are meeting after a month or so. This is going to be our fifth clinical meeting in consecutive year months. We are meeting. That's a good thing. We have not missed even one meeting. Participants and attendance has increased. I see here about 23 people have joined this time. It's a good thing. Now, without wasting time, I'll ask Dr. Maiti to conduct the further proceedings. Thank you.
Thank you, President Dr. Shashank Kulkarni. So, we are just taking this venture to continue with our academic sessions. Because of pandemic, we could not organize our usual program, our usual conference. So,
Hello, everybody. Rajesh here.
Yes, welcome. So, we have just started this, and I hope with the initiation from our senior members and other members, we can have our physical conference. And in the meantime, to get more material for our bulletin, rural surgery, this type of academic program may help us. Now, today's program, there are five presentations, and our president, past president, Dr. Gyanraj, who is also many in charge of many of the academic programs of our association. We are proud of him, and for our international programs, he is doing a lot of works. He is doing a lot of philanthropic works and academic works in the different parts of the country, particularly the rural northeast areas. And he is one of the chairperson of today's program. Dr. Amit Rai, he is the associate professor of NRS Medical College, Department of Surgery. But one important thing I must tell about him, that he was the organizing secretary of our RCCON 2014, which was at Midnapur Medical College. And many of us who are attending today's program were present during that conference. Dr. Amit Rai is also a plastic surgeon. He is MCH in plastic surgery. So now I am handing over the microphone to our president, Dr. Gyanraj, past president, Dr. Gyanraj, and Dr. Amit Rai. Dr. Amit Rai and Dr. Gyanraj, please call the speakers as according to the names given in the program.
Thank you, and welcome to this monthly program that Dr. Sukma Maiti has been regularly organizing. I thank him for his great efforts to getting people together and organizing it. And also welcome Dr. Amit Rai, because I remember the first gasless workshop we had was in Midnapur Medical College. It was a wonderful experience that we had. I think since he's probably more aware of the speakers, I request him to introduce the speakers. I think we are starting with Dr. Mala Mistry.
Yes. Thank you, Professor Maiti and Dr. Gyanraj. Am I audible?
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, you are audible.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Maiti and Dr. Gyanraj. I have a beautiful experience with Dr. Gyanraj and all others in the RCCON 2014 organized in Midnapur Medical College. So we expect a beautiful academic treat this evening. So may I invite Dr. Mala Mistry, who is and associate professor of Department of Surgery, Arjikar Medical College. Dr. Mistry and I was a colleague at Midnapur Medical College. So invite Dr. Mala Mistry for the first case presentation. Dr. Mistry, please.
Thank you, sir. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, you are audible.
Okay, so let's start. Good evening, everybody, and Shubho Vijaya to all of you. Today, our first topic of discussion is on parietal abscess in a patient with colonic carcinoma. So colonic carcinoma is not an uncommon disease. It is one of the leading carcinoma nowadays. But all of we know that colonic carcinoma, most of the patient of the colonic carcinoma usually present with either subacute or acute intestinal obstruction. But patient came to us with slightly different clinical features. I introduce my third year PGT, Dr. Tuhin Shubhro Mondol, who will present the case to you. And now I request Dr. Tuhin to start the case.
Thank you, madam. Good evening to everyone and Shubho Vijaya to all. In this auspicious evening, I am going to share a story of our patient who presented to us with the features of anterior abdominal wall abscess. This is the story of this woman. She presented to us with a progressive painful swelling in the left anterior wall of the abdomen for last 15 days. On presentation, she was afebrile, she was non-diabetic, and there was no history of any immunosuppression. On the further inquiry, we found that there was no history of GI bleeding. She didn't have any history suggestive of anemia. There was no history of pruritus, diarrhea, no PR bleeding, and other signs of malignancy. So on the first presentation, it appears to be a case of parietal wall abscess to us. We examined the patient, we found her to be tachycardic. And on further examination, we found that there was a swelling on the left side of the abdomen around 15 into 20 centimeter in size, which was extending at least 4 centimeter lateral and left to the umbilicus, extending towards the left flank. And it was around 2 centimeter just below from the left subcostal region, extending to the ASIS. We aspirated and pus came out. So on the first presentation, this lady of a 68-year female presented to us with a parietal abscess. We admitted the patient in the emergency department and we did an incision and drainage for this patient. The patient, after the drainage, we put a drain extraperitoneally for the continuous drainage. And after that, we took the pus for antibiotic sensitivity. We first put her on broad spectrum antibiotic. And after the report of culture sensitivity came, we put her on the sensitive antibiotic. This is the picture of this patient after IND on the second week after the OT, and the patient was discharged after second week. This was a case of parietal abscess to us on the first presentation. And after that, there was an interval for 25 days. After 25 days, the patient again came to us in a morning OPD on Monday. But this time, she has a similar kind of presentation on her left side of the abdomen. This time, she had a small collection on her left abdomen on the parietal wall with a continuous discharge, which was mostly pus-like discharge. This time, we thought that probably we have missed something and missed a greater pathology underlying this. So now we investigate the patient properly. We did all hematological examination. We found her to be anemic. And then we did a CECT whole abdomen for the patient. This is a plate taken from the CECT of the patient. And here we surprised to see that there was a irregular polypoidal wall thickening involving the proximal descending colon extending to the splenic flexure of the patient, with there is a adjacent collection which extending into the parietal wall. So this time we understood that the patient who primarily presented to us with the features of parietal abscess, what not only a parietal abscess, it was the presentation of underlying colonic malignancy. In generally, we get the colonic malignancy, precisely left-sided colonic malignancy, in the form of spurious diarrhea, either there is obstruction or there is any alteration of the bowel habit. But this patient, no significant history of colonic carcinoma was there, except this presentation of the parietal abscess. We have another picture of the CT scan. Here you can see also the same features of the polypoidal growth on the left proximal descending colon, as well as extending to the splenic flexure. So this time we understood the pathology and we operated the patient. We operated the patient after optimization. We opened the abdomen with midline incision. There was definite a growth, you can see easily. And the growth is densely adhered to the left parietal wall with a tract fistula, which is not being seen here. So after mobilizing the sigmoid left colon and ligating the sigmoidal and left branch of middle colic artery, we did a left hemicolectomy in this patient, followed by a colocolic anastomosis. This is another picture of the same specimen showing that part of the transverse colon, the huge tumor or growth with a perforation in the center of the patient. As I said that we did a colocolic anastomosis, probably I don't know why the specimen is not being shown. There was a specimen of last part of the transverse colon along with the left colon. The patient was put on ERAS protocol postoperative period. However, she developed surgical site infection. The histopathology report came after 14 days. And it shows that it was a case of mucinous type of adenocarcinoma, which is well differentiated, and tumor invaded throughout the musculus propria and pericolorectal tissue. All the margin were uninvolved by the invasive carcinoma. So clinically, it was a pathologically, it was a PT3 and N0 tumor, as they examined 10 lymph nodes and no lymph nodes were found to be involved by the carcinoma. There was no lymphovascular invasion and no perineural invasion. So for us, we are presenting this case in this forum because the parietal abscess is so much common in our day-to-day practice, as well as the left colonic growth. But we generally get the colonic malignancy in the form of spurious diarrhea, alteration of bowel habit, PR bleeding, or in the form of anemia. But this patient presented to us only with this parietal abscess. This is a rare presentation, and it is found only in case of 0.3 to 0.4% of left colonic malignancy. The perforation is a bit more common because it is only seen in 2 to 10% case of colonic malignancy, but mostly the perforation is interperitoneal. But this case, the tumor invaded the parietal wall, which was extended up to the parietes, muscle, and ruptured outwards. During operation, we cut the portion of the fistula tract and part of the parietal wall. And you can see that the all tumor margin was uninvolved, or the excise margin was uninvolved by the tumor. So this is a rare case. Now the question is, how she is doing now? Did we do a great job for this patient? The answer is on the next slide. No, sorry. This picture is taken after 25 days of this operation, and with a midline scar is there and the site of incision and drainage on the left side of the abdomen. Yeah, this picture has been taken on the ostomy of this ER puja, and it depicts that the patient is doing good after this malignancy and after this operation that management we have given. So with this, I again wish Shubho Vijaya to all, and I'm ending my presentation, and it's open for discussion. Thank you.
A nicely presented case with a rare presentation of colonic cancer, and very well done operation by Dr. Mistry and her team. So now, may I request the other participants for discussion? The case is open for discussion now.
Hello. Yeah. I congratulate the presenter
He appears to be a junior surgeon in the team. He presented the case very well. There's only one observation and one objection. In the very first slide and the last slide, patient was shown to us, to the audience. It is a mandatory that the patient should not be shown in whole, in total. At least her eyes should have been covered, and that is the first rule of any presentation. It is the right of the patient to be not to be shown in a slide like that. Thank you.
Sir, I have a question. If permission is taken from the patient, and if the patient is explained that heart case is being presented, going to be presented in a forum like that, and if she gives permission, and if she herself sent me the photo of her as she is doing good in Vijaya or ostomy, can I do so?
No, I don't. Because this is a clinical presentation, you are not allowed to show the patient on the slides.
Okay, sir.
Let us, we can discuss this point also.
Yeah.
Dr. Gupta, what do you say?
Yes, you are true, sir. First thing is identity of the patient should not be revealed. And even the name which was there on the histopathology report, this one not should be revealed.
Okay.
Yes. This is the thing which we should do. Okay, I just wanted to comment on this case. We also had a similar case where actually this patient of Dr. Mitra, she presented with parietal abscess. But our case, it had a huge necrotizing fasciitis, and we had to debride the whole of the, literally, you can say two-thirds of the abdominal wall. It was necrotizing fasciitis. We had to do debridement. And what we found that actually presented not with the colonic carcinoma, but it presented with the necrotizing fasciitis of the abdominal wall. When we did debridement, what we found was some fissureless tract were there from where the pus was coming. And then we traced it. It went into inside the abdominal wall. We could trace it. It was a huge carcinoma colon, which were around 20 to 30 centimeters of size. And also, it had maggots inside. This was the case we actually, we said, they tried to present, but could not get it ready. So I was also presenting a similar type of case in this forum also. I'll show you sometimes the photographs. But then it was totally fixed growth, could not be removed. But what we did, after the recovery of abdominal wall, we put a mesh there because fascia was also gone. Then afterwards, made a flap, covered it with that, say, whole abdominal wall. And afterwards, gave her anterior chemotherapy or neoadjuvant chemotherapy. And later on, we resected it. So we could do this treatment in this way. Although this is a rare thing, what we get, parietal abscess with this thing, or like in our case, it was a necrotizing fasciitis with underlying carcinoma of the colon.
I congratulate young man for presenting so beautifully, but as you have already said, let us prevent the name and photos should be avoided. Name, you can write KLSDOD, just shortcut name and not full name. And then the photographs, you must cover the eyes and all those things. This is the tradition and we should follow it. Long run, it is very good.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Mondal. Now, we will proceed to our second case. And Subodh Behra is a renowned gynecologist. He has retired from MR Bang Hospital as a gynecologist. And now he is practicing in Midnapur, Tumluk, and also in Calcutta. Well-known gynecologist will present his unusual presentation of a huge cervical polyp. Dr. Behra, please.
Yeah. Good evening. And our chairperson, Dr. Kulkarni, and the RCP secretary, Dr. Rajesh, and also our beloved Sukumar Da, that Dr. Sukumar Gormaiti. I have a great privilege to present this short case. Yeah. And this is a case of undiagnosed big cervical polyp in a postmenopausal woman in rural area. So what do you mean by the term postmenopausal woman? once a woman has gone 12 months without the period, she is considered to be in menopause. The incidence of postmenopausal bleeding PV is about 4 to 8% of postmenopausal women, and common causes are atrophic vaginitis, cervical polyp, which are non-cancerous. In case of postmenopausal bleeding PV, we initially think about the worst diagnosis like endometrial carcinoma or cervical carcinoma. We often miss the diagnosis without doing the proper clinical examination, as it may be due to some atrophic vaginitis or a simple benign small cervical polyp. And in my case, Mishesh A. Ghorai, residents of Tomlu, Purva Midnapur, West Bengal, and she's a housewife and a farmer, aged about 53 years, parities, 2+0, both by cesarean section delivery, and tubectomy was done and last childbirth 18 years ago. She had menopause for 3 years, and my date of examination is 3rd September 2020, that is in last year. And she had the complaint, postmenopausal bleeding for vagina for last 6 months with serosanguinous discharge per vagina. And she had retention of urine in 2 occasions, which is released by catheterization. She was examined by several doctors in the local area, but nobody do the internal examination, not even the specular examination. I think that is the COVID-19 situation. And she was treated by tranexamic acid, doxycycline, and some of the doctors advised for abdominal hysterectomy. But in my clinic, on examination, I do an internal and specular examination, and I found the big cervical polyp almost occluding the vagina. And I do few investigations. She has very low level of hemoglobin, and WBC count is 12,000. Sugar is within normal limit. Thyroid is all within normal limit, though she had a past history of hypothyroidism, and serology was negative. On urine examination, I found nothing significant, but I do an ultrasonogram. We found bulky uterus and large cervical polyp. And this is the picture of ultrasonogram showing cervical polyp. This is one polyp, and another is, this is the polyp. Yes. And then I prepare the patient for operation. But before operation, I transfuse 2 units of whole blood, as the concentrated RBC is not available in this rural setup. And the hemoglobin goes up to 8.5 gram per cent. And I applied local application of povidone-iodine solution twice daily. And my date of operation was 23rd of September 2020. And I do polypectomy followed by thorough curettage under short general anesthesia. And the tissue, both the endometrial tissue and the polyp, was done for histopathological examination. And the patient was discharged on the same day. And this is the polyp looking. You can see this is one polyp, and the same polyp is shown. And when I remove the polyp, this is the picture of the polyp. And on histopathological examination, they give the report, thickened proliferative endometrial tissue, and the polyp was benign. And on follow-up, there is no bleeding per vagina, no vaginal discharge, no urinary problem. And regarding the comments, I think this type of gynecological patient should be examined thoroughly by internal examination, including vaginal speculum. Minimal investigation, that is the ultrasound, should be done, which is cost effective and also available in rural areas, which help early and proper diagnosis. There is no need to do CT or MRI, which is very costly, even not available in rural areas. Thank you. Thank you very much for patience here.
Thank you for the presentation. So one other thing, if we have the facilities, is that you can use the urology resectoscope to have a look inside and vaporize the area where the polyp arises. That can save a lot of blood loss during surgery, but I don't think it could be very significant. Maybe Dr. Samabasu can tell us a little more about.
Actually, on urinary examination, I found nothing significant. Do and just go.
Hello?
Simply go to the vasectomy and urinary.
May I just say a couple of things, sir?
Yes,
sir. Please go ahead.
Sir Vera, it was very nice presentation. Only thing I was wondering, actually, we are all rural practitioners. Before even going for ultrasound, a simple clinical examination perhaps would have solved the problem much earlier.
Yes.
So that has not been done. Even in your case, perhaps you asked for ultrasound first and then decided.
In my clinics, I do first do the examination and do the diagnosis. There is a cervical polyp.
Okay.
But the patients and the relatives want to know, please do one ultrasonogram.
No, that is all right. Always it should be done. Exclude other things. Yes, always it should be done.
Other pelvic pathology.
Yeah, I agree. It is absolutely.
Or any other polyp inside the uterine cavity.
Absolutely. Yes. You see, the postmenopausal cervical polyp is not very. Sorry?
The postmenopausal bleeding is there, but nobody do the internal examination, not even the speculum examination.
Now that's the thing. That is the point.
Things that will do the diagnosis.
And would you kindly, because most of our colleagues are surgeon, would you kindly tell them that what is the cause of postmenopausal cervical polyp? What are the things which precipitate the postmenopausal cervical polyp?
Actually, she had an fibroid. I think that is a submucous fibroid, and that goes outside the internal os and coming to the vagina. That leads to being for vagina for last 6 months with serosanguineous discharge. And she had menopause for last 3 years.
Yes.
They asked me why instead of fibroid, she had menopause. She may continue bleeding, but that is the problem.
Because sometimes hyperestrogenism, the cervical infection, inflammation, whatever you call it, and the clogging of the blood vessels, you know, because of the hyperestrogenism, or a patient who had the previous history of what is that called, proliferative endometrium, that kind of thing. That precipitated to form the cervical polyp. Clogging of the blood vessels, also another important thing, perhaps. And however, what is the incidence of malignancy? Because you didn't find any malignancy.
I think it is around about 0.1% of short of polyp in a postmenopausal woman. And always we are worried about whether it is a malignant one or not. Diagnosis.
Yeah. Thank you.
One other thing that you're worried about is the malignancy. It's less than 1%.
Yeah.
And what about the chance of recurrence? How often does it recur after treatment?
Actually, I do the thorough curettage of the endometrium, and that gives the only the thick proliferative endometrium. I think.
I think
no chance of recurrence. I think so. But
sir,
my follow-up today.
Sir, the indications of abdominal hysterectomy in this in
by the local doctors. They are gynecologists, general practitioners. They give.
Follow.
Doxycycline and without
ওখানে কতক্ষণ বসে থাকতে হচ্ছে
সো দ্যাট দ্যাট পেশেন্ট কাম টু মি
one I would like to share one of my experience very interesting yeah. As you said the gynecologist they didn't bother to do a speculum examination that would have solved the problem much earlier not allowing the patient to bleed for such a long time and undergoing anemia and all these things
yes
I had a case like you as you said ultimately the patient came to me after visiting 6 gynecologists this yes. case I presented in rural surgery bulletin once if you Dr. Ganraj will be able to see it you know this was a case of tuberculosis of cervix which is of course very rare as compared to the general other people so the interesting part of it you see some people also examined finally the one who did it examined diagnosed it straight away cervical cancer and that is how it was sent to me so when I saw the okay. patient
so unless you do the cervical biopsy and
yes that's a very simple thing patient was treated
tuberculosis and cancer
and then it was so simple treatment you know anti-tubercular treatment and within 1 year time patient was absolutely cervix and cannot recognize it was the same cervix it has been presented in bulletin one of the bulletin thank you very much
okay so I we should end this case
go back to the second case
yeah proceed
thank you I invite now Dr. Manoj Ranjan Kar to present about the huge keloid that he has treated
good evening for the chairperson and senior respected members My case is a challenge of management of recurrent keloid in both yellow wound and 12-year-old man. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. The old 12-year-old man reading in the class 6. She presented, she had a history of yellow wound pain at 4 years of age. She developed keloid. She was operated by 7 years of age at a rural nursing home. Recur again and attend my clinic 6 weeks back with huge recurrent keloid. Next slide. Sir, next slide. Yes. You can see the identity is visible. You can see the both ear level has huge keloid. Next slide. Sir, next slide. Yes. The picture of the keloid of the left ear level with ulcerations. Next slide. This is the picture of the right ear level with keloid. Next slide, please. Yes. She was examined and excluded for tuberculosis and diabetes in the patient and in her family. Consent taken from parents about chance of recurrence and regular follow-up. I asked the parents whether you can attend regular follow-up or not because previously, she was operated at the age of 7 years, then it recurred, but she presented to me after 5 years.
5 years?
For that reason, I asked the parents, but taking the consent, you should attend the regular follow-up so that I can pass the patient. Next slide, please. I appointed the patient under local anesthesia. On third post-operative day, I removed the dressing. Asked the patient party to use Neosporin H ointment over the wound and stitches removed on 8th day. Neosporin H ointment continued after 30 days. Next slide. Next slide, please, sir. Yes. After 4 weeks follow up, both the yellow wound. Sir, next slide. Yes. This picture in the post 4 week follow up. Anterior aspect of the left ear lobe. Next slide. Sir, next slide. This is the posterior aspect of the left ear lobe. Next slide. This is the anterior aspect of the right ear lobe on follow-up. Next slide, pass, sir. This is the posterior view of the right ear lobe. Next slide. On follow-up, I have given injection Kenacort within the lagoon of both ear and 4 weeks follow-up. And I presented this patient for prevention of recurrence from the audience for discussion. This is now chairperson, this patient. Next slide, please, sir. Now open for discussion, sir.
Thank you for the wonderful surgery. It looks really very good to see the post-op pictures. Did you do a what we call an intrakeloidal excision or just excise the lesion?
No, sir. I remove more of the tissue. Not excision. Whole excision.
Well, I mean, earlier we were taught intrakeloid excision and steroid injections were taught to prevent the keloid.
At the star site. Within the lagoon.
Basically,
I asked for opinion from the others. The chairperson, right?
Yes. Sir, basically, two types of excision is there. I think you have done extra lesional excision. And if the wound closure is, you think that wound closure is tension free, then you can do the extra lesional excision. And for prevention of postoperative recurrence, usually postoperative recurrence occurs within 1 year. If it doesn't recur within 1.5 years, then you are safe. For prevention, what you can do is intralesional steroid injection, that means triamcinolone. As the area is small, so I prefer 10 milligram per ml of triamcinolone mixed with 2% lignocaine in a 50-50 ratio and applied it once a month for consecutive 12 months. And also you can try silicone gel sheet or a pressure dressing that is available for earlobe as a magnet. So both all these three in conjunction may prevent recurrence in this young lady. But I must congratulate you, Professor Kaur, for a very cosmetically pleasing postoperative result.
The 1 month, 4 weeks follow.
Yes.
It is the 4 week follow.
Yes.
The 4 week follow.
Yes.
The picture.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You continue steroid injection.
Another question.
Mm-hmm.
Another question: whether we can allow the guard to wear the ornaments, whether we allow again to perforate the lagoon again?
Not now. Sir, not now, because scar is very immature now. Once the scar is being matured.
The steroids which we are giving, the problem is that wherever you give injections, a new keloids appear at the site of injections. That is another problem with it. Wherever you give injection.
I must prevent recurrence. First.
Okay.
Yes. Hello.
Doctor,
audio is a bit problem. Audio is a bit problem.
Doctor Gupta. Please make your comment.
I just wanted to ask, which day of surgery you started injections, number one, and how many days or how many years we should use it? There are two questions I want to ask. Like, nice surgery by Dr. Kaur. But just want to ask, which day of surgery these injections were started and then how long they should be continued? Can you hear me?
There I use neosporin H means steroid containing antibody ointment from third post-operative notes. Okay. Applications. Then intracarotid injection of triamcinolone as dose given at the 4 week follow-up. As per the Dr. Roy advice, to be given at 1-1 interval.
Professor Kaur, wonderful cosmetic result, particularly for the left ear anteriorly, which is commonly visible. No scar is there almost, it is scarless. And what I do for this type of cases, I don't know whether our plastic surgeon, particularly Amit Rai, will agree with me or not. After the excision, on the same day of the operation, I put the triamcinolone injection. Initially, I was afraid of the scar dehiscence because of steroid. But because of some study, I have seen that even the triamcinolone can be given into the operative wound on the day of operation, and I continue giving the steroid, as you have mentioned, for 12 months periodically. And regarding the pressure dressing, what I do, I use the common, that is the cloth clipper, which is used for giving the cloths and fixing. I put the cloth clippers after some dressing, I put the cloth clipper to give the continuous pressure. That pressure dressing, application of pressure is very, very useful. Silica, application of silica gel, I rarely use, but when I apprehend that the scar is little bit swollen, I use the silica gel. These three things I follow, particularly I love the pressure dressing with the application of those clips, broad clips.
Yes, sir. It's a new teaching for me also. We usually apply a magnet. That is costly. It's a new teaching for me. Thank you, sir.
That is the
application of clips, real rural thing.
Yes, the rural thing. I am using for a long time. That gives a good result. And it is so effective. I am really wonderful.
That's very nice, sir.
Clips also. We have also learned about use of clips now. That's very fine.
And so many broad types of plastic clips are available. A small dressing, then apply the clips.
Okay. Could we move on to the next case?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Rajesh Trongaonkau will present a case. I hand over the mic to Dr. Ganraj for introduction.
I think Dr. Rajesh does not need any introduction. He is the secretary of the association, and we'll be happy to hear from him. Thank you. Go ahead, Dr. Rajesh.
Good evening, everybody. Happy Dasara, happy Vijayadashmi, everything. This is a rare case. Everybody audible? I am audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Yeah. It's a case of twin pregnancy in a septate uterus. Twin pregnancy in septate uterus is very rare obstetric entity. Usually, Mullen and duct abnormality in general population is about 5.5%. Septate uterus is about 2.3%. And twin pregnancy occurring in septate uterus is a very rare case. A case history, 26-year case of primary infertility conceived after ovulation induction by letrozole. Known case of septate uterus. USG done at 12 weeks shows twin pregnancy in two separate horn of uterus. Diamniotic dichorionic twin pregnancy. Cervical encilage was taken at 18 weeks by McDonald's method and elective LSCS at 37 weeks. There is a male child of 2 kg and female child of 2.1 kg. Sorry. Diagnosis by USG. You can see two separate horns of uterus with two fetuses with a septum inside. Two separate placentas you can see. During the operation of cesarean section, you can see a septum with two endometrial cavities. Suture line of the post cesarean section, posterior aspect of the uterus, and two babies. Thank you. Open for discussion.
There is very short and sweet presentation.
I say a very short case. So, yeah. And straightforward.
Before you go to discussion, I just like to know the, you mentioned some letrozole. I have not heard of that. We have been using clomiphene citrate. When does what is this?
Letrozole is a new drug actually used for ovulation induction.
How is it? What is the dosage and how often?
Actually, 2.5 milligram for 5 days. Oh, second to 6 days.
Can I say something?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Actually, yes, letrozole is much better salt than clomiphene sulfate as far as induction of ovulation is concerned. The sum of the complication of clomiphene citrate can be curtailed by letrozole. And these days, usually for induction of ovulation, people are using letrozole more as compared to clomiphene citrate. But my question to Dr. Rajesh, two or three queries.
Yeah.
one is Dr. Rajesh, as you said that it was a known case of septate uterus. Why? And we all know that in septate uterus, the chances of miscarriage, preterm labor, all these things are very common, very, very common. So why it has not been cut? Because it is so easy these days. Earlier, those days, with the Strassmann operation or what they call it, I've forgotten the name. Yeah. By hemisection, sexing the uterus and cutting from both sides, I have done that. And successful pregnancy, let me tell you. But now our hand really itches for cutting the septum through the hysteroscope. You know, it takes too much time. It is an office procedure.
Yeah,
now.
Yeah, yeah.
So why actually, it is not done?
This patient conceived in second cycle only, so zero of any. She considered in second cycle of ovulation induction.
Oh, ovulation. Anyhow, and the second is from the configuration outside. I feel that it is, isn't it a bicornuate uterus rather than you?
No, it's a septate uterus.
Because the if you see the configuration,
yeah,
the two cornus are quite apart, more than 75 degrees.
Yeah.
So. But if it is a really septate uterus, then it is
septate
really
uterus.
Good. That's nice.
One question, please. I had a similar case.
Okay.
One question.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, Dr. Behra.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Dr. Rajesh, give the cervical cartilage stitch at 18 weeks of gestation. I think it is too late. It should be given between 14 to 16 weeks.
16, yeah. Okay.
Number one. And number two, in case of septate uterus, not a bicornuate uterus, we initially do induction of labor. And if there is recurrent failure, that is early trimester abortion, then we can go for surgery. Initially, we do not go for surgery. Surgery has some complications and it may cause some blockage of the tube. So that is another problem. So initially we do induction and then if there is recurrent miscarriage in early trimester, then we go for resection of the septum by hysteroscope. And third thing is, though we initially do induction by clomiphene citrate, still in few cases, elderly having history of polycystic ovaries, having history of endometriosis and bicornuates, all these things, we do induction with letrozole, which is done by Dr. Rajesh. I think that is the right thing.
Okay, thank you.
First you do the clomiphene citrate and if it is failed, then you go for letrozole.
Yeah, that we routinely do.
Because it will take times. So my question is very important. Why you give this cerclage operation at 18 weeks instead of
18 weeks, patient doesn't come follow up for every month, that is the thing. And if she came at 12 weeks, then she came at 16, 18 weeks. So that is the thing.
You can force to come the patient.
Yeah. That in rural area, we cannot force them. When they come, then they are welcome. That we can say.
Valuable pregnancy, definitely.
Yeah, definitely.
Very well presented, short and brief. But I'll tell you, I also the similar case. Did this cesarean and I was looking for the placenta. And placenta was lying on the other side of it.
Okay.
Placenta was lying on the other side and fetus were lying on one side. So this is not in the same part.
That is not twin pregnancy. That is single
pregnancy.
That's single pregnancy. That was our single pregnancy.
Yeah.
Placenta in one uterus. in one part of the uterus and the it was very floating. The other part was very floating. I removed that other part also, repaired the uterus and closed it nicely. So that is how I did it.
Few of the patients we have done vaporization of the septum when they come for infertility. I would like to ask Dr. Saman Basu, what is the, is there any indications for, other than infertility, is there any other indications for treating the septum if it is there?
Well, I shouldn't say it is indication, but sometimes in early young age, you know, this is also a diagnostic criteria. Good number of patients with septic uterus, and incidence of septic uterus is not less really. It is much higher than bicornuate uterus, you know.
Yes.
So in that case, you know, patients complain of what you call dysmenorrhea. And this case, while diagnosing the dysmenorrhea, investigating the dysmenorrhea rather, we go for ultrasound, we go for so many things. And ultrasound, when we treat the patient conservatively, because ultrasound doesn't, for so many reasons. One is endometriosis, which we used to overlook earlier. And the second thing I must say, whether there is any other pathology related to dysmenorrhea. Now there, I found that even it is written in the literature that even some patients who suffers from younger age, they suffers from dysmenorrhea because of the septic uterus. So if it is intractable dysmenorrhea, not getting relief to anything, one can do the remove the septum because it is so easy. It is virtually a non-operative procedure. You know, these days, just you have to have a hysteroscope and a scissor.
Whether the patient is married or unmarried?
It doesn't matter, sir. It doesn't matter, sir. Just don't go for all those conventional hymen and all these things. You know, patients, if you examine the patient, you will find put a speculum, you find the vagina is spacious enough to put the hysteroscope. And with the hysteroscope, it is just a 2 minutes job. Because you don't have to cut the entire septum. That is another important thing I must tell everybody. You just go up to the first diagnose the ostia on two sides. You just go up to ostia and then thereafter you forget. Because if you go further, it is time consuming. If you go further, there is a chance of perforation, all these things. Our main intention is to that, you know, after ovulation, the ovum comes, you know, and or after pregnancy, it comes and get implanted into the uterus. So,
sir, actually the teenage girls,
yes,
many of the patients initially not agreed with your...
No, I'm not talking of initially. I'm saying that if all procedures, everything fails, you know, if patient is getting treatment earlier. So there you can. That is why I showed initially that it is not an indication.
Medical treatment fails.
Yes, it is not an indication really. But then, yes, you can try. That is another thing.
If you like a less expensive alternative, you can use a cystoscope and Bugby electrode to vaporize and remove these septum and smaller lesions in the uterus.
Yes, yes. If it is,
you just dilate to 30 French with the Hagas and then put in a ordinary cystoscope, less expensive.
We give prostaglandin injection before dilatation, so it makes the thing much easier, you know. And it is so easy, really. Sir, but once you've tried doing it, it is an OPD procedure virtually. So it is good. It all depends where you are doing, because in our setup, we don't charge extra. Our charges are uniform, major surgery, minor surgery, and you know how minuscule it is. But outside, sir, in the name of septum.
Sir, one thing, in the first picture of Rajesh, the uterus looks like a bicornuate uterus.
Yes, yes, I agree with
you. It looks like a septic uterus.
It doesn't look
but
like.
On operating table, it looks like a septic uterus.
No, sir. Here also, again, I will tell you one thing.
Yes.
If you go through the literature, or even I have seen bicornuate uterus, you know, they always have some elongated septum also. So, so it cannot be, you may call it the bicornuate plus septic uterus, or you may call it just simple bicornuate uterus because that septum is always very small, very small.
Partial. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Anything?
Thank you, Rajas.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for good discussion. Yeah.
think Dr. Sukumar Maiti needs no introduction. I think he can present the last case.
So, before presenting, sharing my screen, one question was raised by Dr. Madhumita, Professor Madhumita Mukhopadhyay. She is the professor at Diamond Harbor Medical College. She has placed the question, how I use the TRIPS for the ear lobule postoperative period or excision of the keloid. So actually these are the types of TRIPS I use, and you see how I have applied it on the screen, on my ear. Can you see my ear lobule? Can you see my ear lobule? So after placing a small dressing, that may be a gauze piece or cotton, then I apply this type of TRIPS, or even or even this type of TRIPS can be applied. I use these two types of TRIPS, either this one. Immediately after 7 days, I place the TRIPS after the stitch removal. I place the TRIPS and then I continue it for months. Because if I use for long, because the keloid can, as Professor Rai and Professor Kaur has mentioned, it can recur within any time within 1 year. So I will advise to use the TRIPS for about more than 6 months. Okay, so in this way I use the TRIPS.
Okay, one other thing you need to be careful is about the tension. So you need to make sure that it doesn't apply too much.
Actually,
so it stretches the elastic and...
Yes.
Continuous use 24
hours in a day. No, as much as possible. It should give comfort to the patient. It should not give some pain to the patient. It should give comfort to the patient, and it should be optimum because pressure is a very important measure to prevent the hypertrophic scar or keloid formation.
Be added by steroid injection or not?
Yes, also added by steroid injection. So actually, frankly speaking, I am very lucky enough not to see any significant recurrence in any of the keloid, and we know that most of the keloid are occurring in the lobule. So this type of clips are very easy to apply to put pressure from both the sides, both from anterior, lateral and medial sides. So now I am sharing my screen. It is a case of anal membrane, and we know developmentally anal membrane is the posterior part of the cloacal membrane. We know developmentally the urogenital sinus and the hindgut develops from the same source, and the urorectal septum appears in between to divide the cloacal membrane into urogenital membrane and the anal membrane. So if that anal membrane does not disappear, because it is a bidermal membrane, ectodermal and endodermal fused together, as it is a part of the proctorium and the hindgut. So if by chance it does not disappear or a part of it remains there, then it can cause difficulty in the passage of fecal matter. So initially, so I'm just showing the video, after then we can have some discussion and I will try my best to answer.
A 13-month-old boy was brought with history of constipation since 3 to 4 months of his age. But before that, he had no problem when he used to pass liquid stool after birth. On examination, anal orifice was found adequate at the perineum. On digital rectal examination, one constricting area was found 1.5 cm above the anal orifice. Also, a small folded pinkish mass was noted anteriorly. The operation was done under general anesthesia in lithotomy position. The black thread shown is actually attached to the gauze plug, which is placed in the rectum to prevent soiling of the operation field. Now look at the discoid membrane attached all around at the dented line with a central hole. A vertical cut is made to the membrane at 6 o'clock position. A similar cut is made at 12 o'clock position. Each half of the membrane will be excised in steps, and the cut margin will be sutured with 40 polydricholic acid continuous stitches. Excision of the membrane and suturing is completed on the right side.
This is the dented line, columns of Bartley.
Excision of the membrane on the left side is also completed now. This is the final appearance. The index finger can be passed easily through the anus. 12 by 15 size Hawking Sumner dilator could also be passed easily. The gauze plug from the rectum is removed now. A diclofenac suppository and a betadine salt gauze pack is snugly placed in the anorectum. Anal membrane is categorized as a rare and a low anorectal malformation. It is derived from the posterior part of the cloacal membrane behind the urorectal septum. The membrane may persist as a low anomaly either in the form of a complete membrane or as a perforated wave as in this case. It may be missed if the clinician is unaware of it or omits a rectal examination when examining a case of constipation. It is never associated with any fistula and surgery is simple and gratifying. Thank you for watching the video. A 13-month-old boy was...
This is my presentation. Actually, in this particular patient, I use the continuous suture to stop any form of bleeding. And in the patient is now on 2 months follow-up. Now she can pass stool very easily and no problem, and the parents are very happy. And this is actually a case of anal membrane, which is a congenital membrane. Another condition which is also known as anal or rectal atresia. In that situation, the defect is usually above the dented line, and those defects may be associated with the stricture of that region by affecting the muscle sphincters. So, but here in anal membrane, it is so simple, there is no defect in the muscle level or there is no associated fistula. It is very simple, operation is very simple, just to excise a bidermal membrane, and excision gives a very gratifying result. But this patient is 13 month old and she was suffering for a long time because of the absence of the diagnosis and because rectal examination probably was missed.
Very nice presentation, sir. Similar types of cases, I could also see they are referred from outside and they are missed for many years. And then they come as an anal membrane. So definitely said, any type of child with constipation, you must examine clinically and see this. So, like in the first case also, and this calls a clinical examination is a must. Like in the Dr. Bera's case, the cervical polyp was missed because of no clinical examination. Here also we see pediatricians or pediatric surgeons or general surgeons, they miss because of not doing a clinical examination first. Nicely presented video, sir. Thank you very much for presentation.
Sir, I have got a question. Sir, I'm Dr. Shogoda Rai from Mendipur, sir. I would like to ask if how do you preoperatively diagnose the differentiate between anal membrane and a case of anal atresia? Because in the case of anal atresia, is there any preoperative investigation that we can exclude, or the clinical examination is the only way that we can do? Or what are the points? How do you differentiate?
So, thank you, Dr. Rai. Dr. Rai is also a pediatric surgeon, you must know him. And actually in this particular patient, initially I thought there may be a low anorectal anomaly in the form of anal stenosis, because anal stenosis is much more commoner than this anal membrane. In the I have studied the literature, this type of membrane is very, very rare. The in the literature till now, most of the cases reported are the partial anal membrane, which are attached to either side or anterior or posteriorly. This type of discoid anal membrane, which is central perforation in the form of a wave, is extremely rare. In this particular patient, when I did the PR examination, my finger entered almost easily. But when I was bringing my finger down, little bit hooking, that at the as in the posterior urethral valve, in other valves, my tip of the finger was hitching against the upper surface of the membrane. So that made my diagnosis very clear, and I was very happy to get such case. In the first time, and although for the last time, I have got this case. And I have just shared this case with many pediatric surgeons in Kolkata. They also said it is a very rare case, because atresia is more common, rectal anatomy is more common, anal stenosis is very, very common, but this anal membrane is extremely rare. What is your experience?
Yes, sir, absolutely. I have not seen a case of anal membrane yet, actually, with a central perforation.
Covered membrane, stenosis membranes are common. Covered membrane at the level of the skin, but here
at the level of the skin, that is
more rectal atresia is above the level of the dented line, but yes, this anal membrane is only at the level of the dented line. Anal stenosis, covered membrane are below the level of the dented line. Rectal atresia or anal atresia are above the level of the dented line. But this anal membrane is only attached perfectly along the dented line. That is the interesting part of this case. So I like to share this case with my friends of RC.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you.
Hello.
Hello, Subodh.
Where are you? Anal atresia, she will not pass any stool or flatus, nothing.
No, atresia may be a complete atresia. For example, atresia did not pass, it will be diagnosed most of the time in the congenital, in the neonatal period. But sometimes the stenosis, atresia may be, there may be some small holes like that. It may be, may not be a complete atresia.
Complete or partial in lower, middle or upper, atresia.
It will not pass through, and also associated with fistulas, sometimes associated with fistulas, with urinary tract or vagina like that.
I have a question, sir. I'm Dr. Raman Kataria from Janswasthya Sahyog Bilaspur, Chhattisgarh. So it was a great presentation and also learning a very rare case that you have presented. I was just wondering, like you said that this membrane is exactly at the dented line. It's probably what would ultimately become the anal valves of Paul. You see, looking at the dented.
Yes. You're right.
My question is that, you know, is it possible that one could do less in terms of, like you said, the initial incision was 12 o'clock and 6 o'clock. Was it possible to do only a 3 and 9 o'clock positions and suture it as such, rather than do a circumferential anastomosis, which is prone to stenosis?
No, actually, initially I thought that I am doing a circumferential incision and also doing a with a continuous suture. So I was apprehending that. But I thought, because see, with the staplers, this type of stenosis is not occurring. And this patient is regularly having the graded dilatation in the postoperative period. Every 7 days I was used to doing that, and now the mother is doing the regular dilatation with number 4 anal dilator. And because if I leave a part of the membrane, there is chance of persistence of the membrane and constipation. So I did not like to place any part of the membrane, and dented papillae are actually functionless. They are actually the remnant, congenital remnant. Those are not always present in significant way in most of the persons. So I thought dental papilla has no function, actually. So I removed it to prevent any form of persistence of constipation. This is the first case. I don't know. That is for that reason I have placed it for discussion.
We see more of posterior urethral valve, where again we made only one incision. Sides done once, just cut in 6 and 12 o'clock position and left it. And hopefully the patient has
Dr. Ganraj, no such case report is there. How this patient should be treated? I have searched in the journals, no such case reports with a discoid type of membrane. Only a partial membrane at one corner or one sides are there. So those types of cases are reported. So this is the first case and I have seen. I don't know what should be the best treatment, whether this is the ideal or not.
Maybe the two less cases for a randomized study or something like that. But I think even if you just cut in one place, that should suffice, I suppose, as Dr. Raman said.
But that membrane will persist. If I cut at one end, that dangling membrane, that will protrude. Because you see, it remains folded anteriorly. If I place one half of the membrane, so that half will dangle down. Initially, that was a membrane like that, stitched. But once it is free at the 6 and 12 o'clock position, it will hang down and it will protrude. And we see after the operation that it is not protruding because the wound is situated above. I don't know what should be the actual treatment. I did it like this. I just wanted to share my joy of doing this case because first time I have seen such case.
No, but whatever you have done is very well done. That's important.
Maybe I don't know. That is
very well done. Very well done.
Because rural surgeon have to do some innovation, and that is the learning from you, sir. All of you, sir, you are doing lot of innovative works.
Very well done.
And today in the meeting, I find many senior surgeons, like Dr. Kunal Sarnal is there. Dr. Himanshu Rai, he is also a good teacher. He has written a good book on surgery. They are also attending the meeting. Dr. Madhumita
Mukhopadhyay. Hello, Dr. Himanshu. I am delighted to hear your voice after a long time.
Where you are working now, Professor Himanshu? In which college?
I am এখন পুরুলিয়া মেডিকেল কলেজের ওখানে এইচওডি পুরুলিয়া মেডিকেল কলেজে নাও 3 বছর হতে চললো প্রায়
সো নেক্সট টাইম ক্যান উই এক্সপেক্ট দা কেস প্রেজেন্টেশন ফ্রম ইউ ফ্রম দা আদার পার্টিসিপেন্ট আই
ইফ আই এম ইনফর্মড
নেক্সট মিটিং ইজ অন 28th নভেম্বর সো ইউ প্লিজ সেন্ড দা কেস এন্ড প্রেজেন্টেশন টু মি অর টু ডক্টর কেস মিস্টার কেসো then we will put this case.
Okay. I will contact you.
So all the participants who are joining today, we are very happy. Ganraj will also be happy to see more than 30 participants are continuously present in the meeting today. And so from Ganraj, from me and our president secretary, we request all the participants who are till now in the meeting today to please place your own cases for discussion and sharing your knowledge with us.
I can't resist making a comment. Your video is so clear that I am really astonished.
Who is speaking? Himanshu.
Your video is so clear that I am very glad to see this video.
So before we close, I'd like to remind that we have international IFRS and ARSA, we have a YouTube channel where Mr. Keso will upload
tell the channel about the name of the channel so that all of us should subscribe.
I have
already subscribed. Yeah. So you please tell the
to
the
go to YouTube and type rural surgery. I mean, these two videos will appear, one for doctors and one for patients. Maybe Keso, you can just show how to
share. Keso, please share the type
and
share to the screen.
So that people can subscribe to it.
And as you have 5 minutes left, you can show one of the videos from that channel. And comments, in the meantime, I may request for the comments or suggestion from the participant, other participant. There are also few students, undergraduate and postgraduates. We expect comments from them also.
Okay. If you go to YouTube and type rural surgery, and then click, so this is the channel for doctors. And then there's one more, if you don't, for patients. The patient channel is to help us talk about the various options which are available for rural patients.
I'll show you one where the polyp, cervical polyp is coming up to the touching the thighs. I got a good photograph of that big one.
Yes, sir.
So we'll show you next time. I got some good photographs.
Sir, next time will you show that case, sir? May I ask for that case for your presentation in the next meeting?
No, just a photograph. I'll show you. Okay. Don't need a detailed discussion.
So will you show it today? Will you show it today, sir? That will be good.
Today it is please not start. With me. Just okay. I have to pick it up from the photographs.
Okay. So next on 28th. On 28th, please show. So if a chairperson like, they can make their final comments, and then ultimately they can request Mr. Dr. Rajesh Tangorkar to give the vote of thanks.
Final comments. I'd like to start with the vote of thanks to Dr. Sukma Maiti, who's making this quite popular. And we're getting a variety of good cases. And actually, we need not look for only very rare or unusual cases. Even ordinary cases, if we present and we can discuss how we can treat it in rural areas as compared to medical colleges, urban areas, that will also be helpful. So we can keep presenting cases and have more participation in the discussion. I think that will help quite a bit. And once again, thank Dr. Sukumar Maiti for organizing this wonderful program. Thank you.
Dr. Amit, please ask our secretary. Dr. Rajesh is there.
Yeah, I'm here.
Dr. Rajesh, our very...
Yeah. Dr. Rajesh, please. I thank Dr. all the participants, and I request Dr. Maiti and Dr. Ganraj, please continue this our monthly meetings. So do not stop them, and I request all of them to participate. Thank you for joining.
Excellent.
Dr. Rajesh, one thing I must comment. Today, your slides, the color was so soothing to the eye. Your color of the slides, background, blue background.
Blue. Yeah.
That color.
I'm sitting in my son's room, so that's the thing, yeah.
Okay, fine.
Thank you.
Okay, good night, everybody.
Okay, good night.
Okay. Good night.